If you're comfortable, I'd like to do a word association.
We can try.
Music.
Everywhere.
Music is always around. I couldn't imagine life without it.
It's the most phenomenal thing on the planet, and it just hangs in the universe.
Music is a universal language of all people. Everybody loves music.
Just throwing the word music at me, I don't know, you got a week for me to answer?
For me, music is life.
You start off from when you first envision where a song could go. The whole journey is all about the connection to that person.
I'm not a huge verbal guy, but I can really communicate a lot through an instrument.
Music gives me that relationship with you where you feel like you know me, you my friend, I raised you.
Good evening, Los Angeles.
Whether you're doing classical, jazz, pop, rock, folk, doesn't matter. It's about the emotion.
It's unreal to be the person that carries that sound to people.
You just want it to sound right.
Sound right. Right, right.
It's a very, very odd time for music.
So the last 5 years, I think we've hit the valley of sound quality.
You don't hear the complexity of a song with compressed MP3s.
You're just constantly listening to something low quality with some low quality earphones or through low quality speakers, and you're not really hearing everything.
Compression removes up to 90% of the original song, and I think that, you know, people aren't aware of that.
We have a McDonald's generation of music consumers.
Pandora's box is open, and we're living in it. But it's possible for the stuff to sound a lot better than it does.
You've spent a lot of time getting something right. You want it to be like how you imagined it. How it was to you when you were making it in the studio.
When I write a piece of music, I write it in my head, and it sounds really great. And then I try to use technology and musicians, and all I'm trying to do is get that thing that's in my head out there into the reality so I can share it with people.
I don't wake up with, like, a brand new song in my head.
Like, waiting for something that never comes.
For me, it's like a labor of love. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of work to get a song to the point that I'm ready to, like, put it out in the world.
When I think of an album, I think of it as an adventure, a journey through a lot of different soundscapes. As a producer, when I work with different people, I get the opportunity to try something different.
This is like, how am I going to bridge, you know, my world with the Linkin Park world?
You take someone and you make them the best they can be. You create continuity, you create a sound, you help mold it together to be a work.
Whatever's in my head, 99.4% of the time, it comes to life. Because it's about finding the right people. I take the guards off and say, what do you think is best? What do you feel?
It's the idea of taking people where they haven't been before.
I got it cranked all the way up, everything else is down.
Making songs, it's building a house of cards, right? So you choose each drum, you choose each mic, and you do the same for guitar, you do the same for bass, you know, whatever instruments are in your song.
I like to start with a drummer and get the pace and the tempo, and then a guitarist to, like, decorate, and then just, like, build it.
Until you've written the last note, you don't even know how to describe it. But you're chasing something, and you can't put it into words. It just is pure instinct.
It'll be a mix of, this is it, this is the best, I'm so excited, and then, like, I hate it. How did we get here? I don't know how we can fix it.
You always want to satisfy yourself. Oh, that could be better, this could be better. Let's do it again. Really pressurizing yourself and delivering something, there's some magic in it.
Here, sing it in. Let's see how it sounds.
Waiting for the night, waiting for the light that never comes.
if you simplify everything, all the knobs and the toys, does it make you tap your foot? Does it make you want to cry? Does it make you call your girl, guy, whatever? You know, does it trigger that emotion?
It's that connection between you and your instrument and your voice that's really making the music, and it's that interaction of everybody playing the same song and that combustible thing that happens when it all clicks.
There's a lot of work that goes into it to make it just listenable for other people's ears.
And then
I chase the soul, waiting for a...
It's like either hard or weird. Let me do it again.
One of the hardest moments for anybody, musician, songwriter, producer, anybody, when is it done, right?
When I get moved, somebody else is gonna get moved. And I go with my goosebumps.
Man, the get it right part don't come until people tell you it's right. I mean, you have an initial feeling that, hey, I got it right, this shit feel good, it's banging. My confirmation is usually my homies, or I gotta have a bunch of girls, because the girls gonna tell you the truth. You know, if they say, hey, they get, that's what I'm looking for. That's the note I'm looking for right there.
Waiting for a light that never comes.
A lot of care is taken in putting all that together. And then it turns into an album, and somebody streams it in the worst possible compression format and then listens to it on earbuds or their shitty laptop speakers. Then it's kind of like a lot of that work kind of goes nowhere.
Music is art, right? And recorded music is just a way of capturing the art so you can listen later or listen elsewhere. Recorded music has only been around for a little over 100 years, so it's all pretty recent.
In the 60s, it was vinyl.
It's like having a novel or just an artifact. I love objects and just kind of memorable things.
There's nothing like waiting for that pause before it starts. It's sort of magic.
As a kid, wasn't no scratching or rewinding the record. It was just letting it play and enjoying the words, the music, and the feeling, and that's it.
Vinyl is Nirvana, not the group.
8-tracks are kind of the first step in increasing that portability of audio.
I didn't like 8-tracks. The tape was always falling out. They were just a pain in the butt.
I still love cassette tapes. It reminds me of my childhood. And my mum got me a ghetto blaster. I had Bad on tape.
Baby One More Time, I listened to that song over and over and over. You got to the end of the song. And then just like play again and be like, yes, I love this song.
I'm definitely part of the cassette tape generation. It was all about the mixtapes. Actually, those were my favorite presents to give to girls.
And then cassettes became portable because of the Sony Walkman.
Loved my Walkman.
Music when you're on the go, it's crazy.
Sony Walkman was the shit because it was personalized. It's just you enjoying his music.
I remember when the CD first came out.
You couldn't wait to read the album sleeve and the lyrics and who took the pictures.
And then Discman changed listening habits because you could listen to the same song over and over again.
Yeah, I could just skip. I was like, what?
I never had one. I always wanted one.
And then compression came in, like a blessing and a curse.
Digital is the future and the present.
We're dealing in the world with so many compression sources right now, whether it's MP3s, it's satellite radio, it's streaming music, everything's on your phone or your computer or your car.
The transition to the MP3 changed everything.
Lossy compression algorithms were developed that get files down to about a tenth of the size of the CD version.
They use a perceptual model to try to figure out what part of the music can you not hear, and they eliminate that.
It's the idea of take a paragraph of text and take out every fourth vowel from that text. If you just read the text, your brain will fill in those blanks, no problem. So now all of a sudden you've got a file that's a small enough data rate and a small enough size that you can put 1,000 of them on your phone, you can stream 24 hours a day.
In 2006, physical was the driving business. The percentage of physical to digital was 90-10. In 2014, we barely sell any physical at all. Maybe one release in the entire year. It's completely flipped.
Streaming for me is incredible. I think it's probably the best thing that's happened, and the worst. But I feel like I am a bigger music fan today because of it.
Someone will mention a band, and you can listen to it right then and there.
You are constantly opening little doors and finding cool stuff all the time.
And for free. I mean, talk about the streaming services, that's fine, but YouTube has the biggest music collection on Earth.
I use MP3s for referencing stuff. It is very convenient, but it's not for enjoying a hi-fi recording.
When MP3s first came, people thought, okay, this is just the introduction. This is just what we're gonna do for now. And then technology is gonna improve the codec and it's gonna sound better. However, we kind of got stuck there.
MP3, dangerous. Because it's not what is faithful to the original recording.
Portions of the original signal just aren't there anymore. If you really go into the nuances and the detail of the music, some of the things are missing.
Compression does take the emotion and the life out of music.
They watering it down and they diluting it and they making the sound thinner.
It's getting rid of high frequency information, which really creates that clear vocal or guitar.
Whenever I called you, I couldn't say. It was only yesterday, but yesterday so far away. What's CTA?
It takes away the transients, drums, cymbals, claps, beats, pops, clicks. All of those things that really make the music special.
You can absolutely get to the point where nobody cares. Like, you play that back really crappy speakers with a bad source file, and it will completely change your perception and your ability to connect, and it just doesn't make sense anymore.
When you make a record and you're in the studio and you have all the tracks and everything is like right there in front of you and you can hear every instrument and you know exactly what it's supposed to sound like, and for it to come out compressed, it's almost like, why did you put all the work into it in the first place? Because you don't hear it that way.
It's a distortion of the art. It's like looking at a Van Gogh through filtered glasses.
The whole challenge of everything right now in the arts is convenience. What we've learned in the last 10 years is people will sacrifice anything for convenience.
I started cataloging what all of the different music services were using for their file types, and it was only about the size of the catalog and the ease of delivery. They are in a content delivery business, and the content just happens to be music. And if people want to just subscribe to kittens instead of music, that's it. They will start delivering nothing but kittens.
Convenience equals more sales, and then more sales equals shittier quality control.
Stuff gets marketed in such a way that people get confused. You just get shiny lights and colorful logos and stuff that looks really cool hanging around your neck. It's more of a fashion statement than it is actually a good quality audio product.
It's pretty laughable. And so what you're doing is you're taking the worst possible representation of the music and listening to it through the worst possible equipment.
We're content. We live in a world where if you're content with it, hey, if it is better, so what? I like Denny's, you like what? Olive Garden. They say Olive Garden is the Italian Denny's. Not to me, it's the shit. I love it.
Yeah, you can fill your stomach with it. But we're not talking about filling your stomach, we're talking about filling your soul.
With TV, as soon as there was any technology that would make it look better, everybody wanted it. Because they could see it, they believed it. Whereas with music, there was all the functionality that people wanted. No one ever said that they were giving up audio quality. They pretended that it was just as good because that's what they were selling. And they basically hid the fact that it sounded like crap.
I would say most people don't actually know that they're missing out.
So that's the cold thing, is that nobody knows and nobody cares. Their ears are tuned to whatever we have. This is all we have.
doing the listening rooms, one thing we were noticing is, I called it the head bob test, but you start streaming a lower bitrate MP3, and all the people who like the song will start bobbing their heads, and they'll get into it. Then you go back and play the high-res version of it, and usually four times as many people will move their heads. Four times as many. It's not like there's one dude who likes this more.
It's a shame that right now we're sort of cheating people out of that. We're only giving them the cherry, and they're not digging into the main part of the cake.
As a listener, what actually upsets me more than losing the quality is I'm losing the entire artistic experience. That when an artist creates an album, they think about sequence, the liner notes, what is the packaging, what is the title of this album, you know, and nowadays, most people get their music through YouTube.
An album for me was a world unto itself.
I remember opening up albums and just looking at who wrote this song, who produced this song, looking at the pictures and the, like, this shit is fly. And you would appreciate the music that much more based on the passion that that artist put into that project.
It's very easily accessible, so it's very easy to throw away now. Even in myself, I never used to skip things. I used to just listen to the whole album.
Now it's like, what's new? Preview? No, I don't like it. Preview? I don't like it. Preview? That one's good, bye. It's a little bit of a lonely experience, which is not, I don't think, at least our music isn't necessarily made to be that.
Music is and always will be the biggest source of entertainment and communication for people. We just have been sort of lost in this black hole of how we get it and how important it is and how much we should appreciate it.
I don't want my name associated with low quality things, so if I was in control, I'd want everything to be the highest quality possible. I don't understand why it isn't, really. Why isn't it? Who's got the answer to that?
We are on a path with the technology. We can't get off that path. So we have to invent a new way to get music to people.
It has to be artist-driven. It's our job to think in an original way and come up with the answers. Artists not just as musicians, but I mean artists, scientists, artists as builders of great equipment.
I'm driven by the emotional experience that music creates in people. We've got huge libraries of music out there that contain compressed media, and there's technologies that can help address that issue. Let's make stuff sound better. Let's bring back the quality, not just in one dimension, in all dimensions.
Myself in a second, I found myself in a second-hand guitar. Never thought it would happen.
The thing about technology is it's moving forward. It's always going to be moving forward. Some stuff is positive, some stuff is negative. Music is part of your body, it's part of your system. So music isn't going anywhere. It's part of what makes us tick.
It's your love.
When something can change the way you feel, physically, you feel different after hearing something. It makes you want to do right by it.
It's your love.
Feel the same way. When we have a great record, we want the whole world to hear. We want you to experience what we experience. It's our job to make you feel good. We love passing on that feeling, that good feeling.
Is your love big enough? The past is done. Is your love big enough for what's to come?
Thank you so much.
just throwing the word music at me. I don't know, you got a week for me to answer?
For me, music is life.
You start off from when you first envision where a song could go. The whole journey is all about the connection to that person.
I'm not a huge verbal guy, but I can really communicate a lot through an instrument.
Music gives me that relationship with you where you feel like you know me, you're my friend, I raised you.
Good evening, Los Angeles.
Something low quality with some low quality earphones or through low quality speakers and you're not really hearing everything.
Compression removes up to 90% of the original song, and I think that, you know, people aren't aware of that.
We have a McDonald's generation of music consumers.
Pandora's box is open and we're living in it, but it's possible for the stuff to sound a lot better than it does.
You've spent a lot of time getting something right. You want it to be like how you imagined it.
Whether you're doing classical, jazz, pop, rock, folk, doesn't matter. It's about the emotion.
It's unreal to be the person that carries that sound to people. You just want it to sound right.
Sound right.
It's a very, very odd time for music.
So the last 5 years, I think we've hit the valley of sound quality.
You don't hear the complexity of a song with compressed MP3s.
You're just constantly listening to
how it was to you when you were making it in the studio.
When I write a piece of music, I write it in my head, and it sounds really great. And then I try to use technology and musicians, and all I'm trying to do is get that thing that's in my head out there into the reality so I can share it with people.
I don't wake up with like a brand new song in my head.
Like, waiting for something that never comes.
If you're comfortable, I'd like to do a word association.
We can try.
Music.
Everywhere.
Music is always around. I couldn't imagine life without it.
It's the most phenomenal thing on the planet, and it just hangs in the universe.
Music is a universal language of all people. Everybody loves music.